this was a painting that was painted by a surrealist painter. I wish we would have time to do surrealism, because it's a very interesting artistic movement that happened in the early 1900s in Europe. The writing under this pipe, this painting of the pipe, is written, "This is not a pipe." That's what the translation is. "Ceci n'est pas une pipe," meaning "this is not a pipe." And this painting plays tricks on the mind. Is it true that this is not a pipe? What's the trick being played here when the painter writes, "This is not a pipe"? It's not a pipe, it's a painting of a pipe. I don't know if you get the difference. So what the painter is referring to here is the fact that this representation that you're seeing here on your screen is not a real pipe. It's just a representation of the pipe. It looks exactly like a pipe, as you would see, but it's still not the pipe itself. If you want to smoke a pipe, you'd still have to get a real pipe, put the tobacco in and smoke it. So basically what she's doing is introducing a difference between the representation of what we see and say and paint and picture and reality. She's saying that this is a very good representation of reality, but it is still not reality itself. If you want to smoke, you can't smoke this picture. You have to go and look for a pipe to smoke it and put in the tobacco to smoke it. So this is not a pipe, but it's a fairly exact representation of a pipe. And anytime anybody sees it, they will see a pipe. And imagine if somebody who has never seen a pipe, they would not know what it is by looking at the picture. They would just see something like a brown tick on a picture with some words at the bottom. But because they've never seen a pipe, they don't know it's a pipe. So basically she's saying, if somebody had the actual pipe and gave it to that person, then the person would be able to ask, what is this for? What does it do, etc. So basically the painting is pointing us to the difference between the representation through language and images and reality. In other words, the words we say and the pictures we make and the images we have may be very close to reality, but they are still not a substitute for reality. They are different. Next picture. Have you talked about Ferdinand de Saussure? He was a Swiss linguist whose ideas about linguistics have been captured by his students in a book of Introduction to General Linguistics or something like that. What Saussure did was that he identified the difference between sign, signifier, and the signified. There's the sign, which is made up of the signifier plus the signified. This guy Saussure came up with an explanation. He's an explanation of language, what language is. He said that language is a system of signs. Each sign represents something else. Okay, so there's the signifier. The word that we use, or the painting, is the signifier because it is signifying something else. It is telling us about something else other than itself. And then there's the signified. So in the case of the pipe, if we go back to the pipe, we have said this picture is not a pipe. It's a picture of a pipe, but it's a very good representation of a pipe, but it is not a pipe. So when we come to this picture that we see here, we have an animal that we call cat or packer. But you have two different words there, packer and cat. Two different words that mean the same animal, that are referring to the same animal, the animal that you're seeing in the picture. What is the relationship between saying packer and and seeing the animal. There's no obvious representation. It's just that a language has assigned a word so that anytime you hear that word, what comes to your mind is this animal. So the signifier is paka, but the signified is the cat itself, the animal itself. In fact, the animal itself doesn't know it's called a cat, or it doesn't know it's called paka. It only sees human beings and wants food or whatever. It doesn't know what we call it. Maybe it can learn if it hears that a word being said many times and we give it food all the time, then it will figure out, oh, it's me you're talking about. But there's no natural relationship between a word, cat, and the actual animal. This kind of relationship is called an arbitrary relationship. It's arbitrary. There's no relationship between cat, paka, and the actual animal. The sign which makes us think of a cat is assigned to the animal arbitrarily. So that is a symbol. Okay, so we are talking about signs. The first type of a sign is a symbol. And a symbol is where there is no natural relationship between the word or the sound and the animal or the item which it is depicting. Okay, so for example, I can say mti. I'm talking about the plant. But there's no relationship between mti and the plant itself. It's an arbitrary relationship. It's not obvious. Okay, I'm coming to the point. I'm sure this sounds very abstract. And for me, when I started learning it, it was so abstract. In fact, that's why I didn't do well. I'll get to the point. So this one I think is fairly obvious, although I wish I had gotten a different kind of picture. Imagine that caution men at work is not there. When you see this sign with this figure here, you immediately know if you are a driver, and we are even taught at driving school, that if you see this, it means that there are some roadworks ahead and that there are some people who are working there and that you should slow down. In fact, that's the way road signs work. Road signs work by giving us something and then people reading what it means even without being told. In this case, where you have a man whom we imagine is digging, we immediately know that it's about road workers because we see road workers digging and using shovels and pangas and jembes and all that. So the relationship between this figure and the men and sometimes women working on the road is there's a relationship. It's not arbitrary like in the other case. So this kind of the sign is called iconic. It's iconic because you're using an icon that resembles the reality. So when you see a man with a djembe putting a djembe on the road, a spade on the road, and you don't need to be told, you immediately associate it with the people who you're going to find working on the road. So there's a resemblance, that's what I'm saying. In the previous one, if I say cat, and you see the animal, there's no resemblance between the word I have spoken and the animal. But here there's a resemblance between the picture and the people working. It's not exact, but there's a resemblance. And that's called iconic. Then the last sign I'm going to talk about is called an index. Index is where there's a direct relationship between the sign and what it signifies. If you see smoke like this, smoke is always related to fire. So when you see smoke like this, you will assume there must be fire somewhere in the town. Wherever this smoke is coming from, there's a fire. which is what our proverb says, wherever there's smoke, there's a fire. So there's a direct relationship. Smoke does come from fire. Okay, so when we see the smoke, we know there's a fire because we know in our minds that smoke comes from fire. All right, and that is now what you call an index. There's a direct link between the signifier, the smoke, and the signified, which is a fire. Why am I going through all this? When we now come to public narratives, what happens with language is that people change. They use certain signifiers, knowing that the public is going to think in one way, but what they are signifying is something else. And that's what I'm going to show you throughout today's class. And that's the point I'm going to be, we are making throughout this class, that people are using language and symbols, which they know the public will think it means this. But when the public comes to the actual object, they find that something else is being symbolized. And this explains the confusion of Kenyans about many things. And I'm going to give some examples as we go along. It's a trickery on the mind. I think it's called psyops, you know, using psychology to manipulate the way people react or do things. So that's now what is happening with language. We've gotten to the point where the language we are given is it makes us think one thing, but actually the purpose is to do something else. Before I get to now the way language is manipulated like that, I want to just clarify that the way we human beings operate, we operate through conversation, or in a way, argument. And the point of the discussions is to discover the truth together. So for example, if you want to know the direction of a place, you do it through conversation. You ask somebody, how do I get here? And they explain. And if you don't understand, you ask another question like that. And the same thing happens for all other things that human beings do. We have to be able to be in conversation so that we are able to understand different truths about ourselves. Now, the same thing, argument, the purpose of argument, which is what Kenyans don't understand. Kenyans think argument is quarrel. But argument actually is about the search for truth, where you have two different sides saying something, responding to the other, adding more evidence, so that through the discussion and through the agreement and disagreement, you can come to an understanding of what the issue is. Okay, that is another thing that has been poisoned again. We have come to think that argument and debates are quarrels and fights. But actually, if we are supposed to use argument, we are supposed to have a discussion. We are not supposed to agree, but it's supposed to be that you present your side of an issue. And then I say, oh, but if you say this, how about this? And then I add my view. And then you respond to what I said. You said, okay, you have said this. The problem is here, or I agree up to here. What about this? So that's how an argument is supposed to go, so that people are able to finally arrive at an understanding of a phenomenon through discussion. Now, for that to happen, there must be an assumption that we are being honest on both sides. We are being honest and we have goodwill. So if I say, for example, exams should be done away with, okay? Now, if we have a debate like that, and there are some people saying, no, we need exams, and there are others who are saying exams should be done away with, the assumption when you come to a conversation is that We are both trying to find out what is good for our students. Okay, the point isn't to win an argument or to prove that you're right. The assumption is that we are both coming to this conversation with the goal of finding out what is a better way, what is a good for our students. So somebody will say we need exams to maintain quality of education, and the person on the other side will say, no, that is not, quality doesn't happen when you have education. In fact, what you have is cramming. And then the next person, then on the first side will say, but maybe cramming is not so bad because there's some knowledge that we all need to know and we can only know through memorizing. And then I say, but cramming cannot be applied everywhere. And maybe I suggest instead of exams, we should have me, I would say lottery for choosing where people go. So the goal in such a discussion, it is assumed if we are all human beings who love each other and care for society, the assumption is that when we are having that conversation, we are discussing in goodwill. And that at the end of the conversation, we might even decide, actually, the problem isn't exams, the problem is something else. Because through the discussion, we've discovered that the issue isn't exams. So what I'm saying is that whenever we come to a discussion in which we have different points of view, the assumption in a normal society where people respect one another, the assumption is that we are being honest about our opinions and that we are willing to listen to the other person and respond to that person. So now, and we're going to have a discussion about forgiveness and judging and that stupidity that people talk about in the name of faith. So when you hear people saying things like that, like stop judging, what they are doing is refusing to participate in a conversation. They're saying, I don't want to talk about this, the reasons why we, you know, can be varied. I don't want to talk about this, so I'm going to shut down the conversation by saying, you're judging. And this happens in so many ways in Kenya. You know, people don't want to discuss things. So you're accused of judging, you're asked for solutions, you're asked what about I don't know who, and I'll talk about some of those fallacies later on. But basically what is happening is that there's no discussion. One side has decided I don't want a discussion, and we'll go into the reasons why later on. But my point here is to say that the point of discussion is to discover a truth together. And the assumption on both sides or on all sides is that we are going to be honest and we are going to listen to each other. And that this goal, our goal is not to win, but to come to understanding a greater truth. Sometimes that truth may be on one side, but it doesn't matter on which side, or it might not even be among the two discussants. It might be beyond them. But whatever the case, wherever the truth is, the point is to discover it together through conversation. Okay. I'm coming now. This is going to be a bit complicated. Even me, it's taking me a while to get from step to step. Okay. So we've talked about how language is split. Language is split so that we have signifiers and signified, which are completely being disrupted, so that the people who speak are actually intending to say something else other than what we think they are saying. And the other thing they play on is our assumptions about them. And like for me, that's what happened when I started discussing CBC. Me, I thought we were all the educators were being honest and engaging in an honest conversation. I discovered something else, but I will show you examples just to show you how it works. Eh? All right. So now the next thing I want to say is what I've already mentioned, that there are people who, because of the interests they are pursuing, They want to subvert the conversation. They want to disrupt the language because their interest is not in coming to an understanding about the truth. Their interest is in another agenda. And it's in an agenda that they don't want people to realize or to see. So they do it by disrupting, you disrupt the language so that people don't see what you're actually talking about or what you really want, or you just keep avoiding the reality. You keep not letting reality come into the conversation by doing the don't judge, let's forgive. You know, all those things Kenyans like to say when something is too unpleasant to talk about, or when they don't want somebody to be held to account for what they are doing. But okay, I'm saying it in abstract, but you will see now when I'm talking about it. Now, I think now, because I've talked too much theory, let me just go to practical examples so that we know what we are talking about. And then we'll come back to the theoretical explanation of what is going on.